Good morning. Welcome to worship. Welcome to the day after Groundhog Day. Actually, yesterday was Candlemas. No, 2 days ago, Candlemas, which is traditionally the day of Jesus' presentation in the temple. And, you know, I've read that in some places they don't undecorate their tree until Candlemas Day. So if you're like us and your tree is still up, you have an excuse. But anyway, this is the fifth, is it the fifth Sunday after the Epiphany? Wow, time is going. It is also the day of our annual meeting. So following this service, if you can make your way to the, you'll hear more from Ed, to the fellowship hall. We have a luncheon and our annual meeting will follow after that. If you're visiting, you're certainly welcome to come and see what that's like. You can kind of learn the secrets of the congregation, right? But welcome to, especially to some guests. I see we have a couple. And my mom's even visiting. Yay, Mom. And we have a special guest preacher, and that is Steve Cox, who is, he's in the Psalms program in our synod, where a lay ministry program. So he is going to be bringing the message to us today. Thank you, Steve. Yay. And since I got a supply preacher over at St. John's, that meant today, it's like yesterday, I was like, what do I do? No sermon to plan. I just, oh my. Any case, I would like to offer some special prayers, and this is from a request. Pat has been going through cancer treatment, and you know that, some of you know that Sharon Driscoll has been in and out of the hospital lately. She's back home now, but I think last week she went in at least twice. So we would like to extend some, take a moment for a special prayer. Since Pat's here with the pink hat, you can extend a hand toward her, but Sharon would normally be sitting right about where? Right here. So if you extend a hand in this general direction, your prayers will go to both Sharon and Pat. Lord Jesus, you are the one with a touch of healing. So we ask you, Lord, as we extend our hands, that you reach out and lay a hand upon Sharon and Pat. Let them feel your love, your assurance, your strength. We pray for health and wholeness. And we pray this in your most holy name. Amen. Let's stand and join in singing our opening hymn, On Eagle's Wings. Follow the numbers, because you sing verse 1, then the refrain, verse 2. Go back to that refrain, which is in the middle of that page. So it's sometimes hard to follow, but we'll make our way through.
I
You'll find our confession and announcement of forgiveness in your bulletin. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the Word made flesh, our life and our salvation. Amen. Trusting the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior, let us confess our sin. God of life, you promise good news of great joy for all people, and call us to be messengers of your peace. We confess that too often we hoard our joy, our resources, and our security. We nurture conflict and build barriers, and we often neglect our neighbor's needs. Have mercy on us. Where we are self-centered, open our hearts. Where we are reluctant, give us courage. Where we are cynical, restore our trust. Renew us with your grace and restore the hope of eternal life in you. Amen. Hear the good news. We are children of God and heirs of God's promises through the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus, we are forgiven and redeemed. Sing with joy, for all the ends of the earth shall know the salvation of God. Amen.
Let us pray. Everlasting God, you give strength to the weak and the power to the faint. Make us agents of your healing and wholeness, that your good news may be made known to the ends of your creation. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen.
Please be seated.
The first reading is from Isaiah chapter 40, verses 21 to 31. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretch out the heavens like a curtain and spread them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they that planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth, when he blows upon them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me? Or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see. Who created these? He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name. Because he is great in strength, mighty in power, no one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and assert, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youth will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. The word of the Lord. The second reading from Psalms 147, verses 1 through 11. Well, please read responsively. It's in today's bulletin. Praise the Lord. How good is it to bring praise to our God, for he is gracious, and a song of praise is fitting.
The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the outcasts of Israel.
He heals the brokenhearted and binds their wounds.
He turns the number of stars. He gives all of them their names.
Great is our Lord, abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure.
The Lord lifts up the downtrodden, he casts away the proud.
Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make melody to our God in the lyre.
He guards the heavens with clouds, prepares rain for the earth, makes grass grow on the hills.
He gives to the animals their food, and the young ravens when they cry. But the Lord takes pleasure in those who fear him and who hopes in his steadfast love. The word of the Lord.
Gospel for the fifth Sunday in Epiphany. It's from Mark chapter 1, verses 29 through 39. Glory. As soon as they left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with John and James. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. And then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sunset, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed by demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door, and he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place where he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted him. And when they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." And he answered them, "Let us go to the neighboring towns, so I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And then they went out through all Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. This is the gospel of the Lord. This is the fifth Sunday in Epiphany, and Epiphany is the season in the church years when the lectionary gospels are centered around the retelling of the early stories of Jesus, the incarnate Son of the Triune God, a God who loves his people beyond all capacity to understand fully, and who became flesh in the human form as Jesus, and who would become light of the world. And we see that on our banners here. Jesus, who would be willing to accept death on the cross for the salvation of mankind. While the faith I have today is essentially that same faith I had on the day I was confirmed, the priorities that guide how I live out that faith have changed from a focus on heaven and salvation, which allowed me to be more limited in my individual relationship with God and not participate openly with the congregation, to a focus more on bringing God's kingdom to earth now in the present, a focus that is more amenable to a faith community like ours here at Redeemer. You can do that more with your goals in bringing God's kingdom to earth if you're present in a congregation that's active. For me, these periods of reassessment have always come during the season of Epiphany. So I'm very happy, and I welcome it every year. Not as a flash of revelation, though, but more as a clearing and a lifting of the fog, allowing one to see more clearly. So in today's message, in Mark's gospel, We're only about 40 verses into the first chapter of Mark, which the modern Bible scholars tell us is the earliest of the gospel accounts, written about 70 AD. Here we find Jesus on the threshold of his ministry, a ministry that's focused on the liberation of the marginalized and disenfranchised members of the Jewish society in Palestine. An oppressive life under the violent and brutal rule of the Roman Empire and their local collaborators. It's a ministry based on unconditional love that might enable the oppressed to resist the oppression. It's in a ministry initiated in only three, it's a ministry performed in three short years that initiated faith that has lasted and persisted for the last two millennia. In last week's message, Pastor Greg described how Jesus' compassion and love easily triumphed, rebuked and cast out the demons and evil that had persecuted or possessed the man in the synagogue with unclean spirits. Jesus demonstrated great authority in his teaching, and he's already a growing celebrity among the common folks. But it may be that he's also being noticed and being noticed by the high priest and scribes of the temple, who may see Jesus' teachings and healings as a potential threat to the status quo of worship within the synagogue and life as they knew it. This week's gospel readings follow on immediately. Mark continues to show Jesus' compassion for the outcast and marginalized in society in the home of Simon, in a more private setting where women would be more commonplace and have access to his teachings. It's here we learn that the mother-in-law of Simon was had a disabling fever. And we get this from Luke's accounts, because this story is in all three of the synoptic gospels. Her condition is brought forward to Jesus, who immediately takes her by the hand, lifts her up, and her fever is immediately gone, immediately and completely eliminated, to such an extent that she it feels confident to resume her daily life as she is accustomed to, which is providing service for the male occupants of the house. While we may not find this to our liking, it was certainly part of the first century Christian lifestyle. The fact that the first person to be healed in Mark's narrative is a woman is significant and shows from the very beginning that Jesus chose to help those in society that are marginalized, and shows how important women were as Christ's followers. And they are the only followers of Christ that remained with him to the end of Good Friday. That evening at sunset, at the end of Sabbath, Jesus cured many others that were brought to him in Simon's house. However, early the next morning, Jesus withdraws to a desert place to pray and meditate. And while his companions finally locate him, they tell him that all are searching for him, requesting his assistance to be healed and ministered to. Jesus tells them that they need to move on. They need to move to the next town. For he is there to proclaim the message to all. For his ministry to all God's people must take precedence over the people of Capernaum. Many of the people are seeking Jesus out for relief, and he seems unable to keep pace with the incredible demands that humans place on him. The message of the gospel is bigger and more important than Jesus just healing the sick. The message of the gospel is that time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is coming to us through Jesus. It is a message that Jesus came to proclaim, and it's bigger today. And it is the same today. The message of the gospel is still greater importance than healing the ills of individuals. As followers of Christ, we are also called to this work. That is, to act justly, to love kindness and mercy, and to walk humbly with God. And as Lutheran, we are mindful of Martin Luther's concept of living with a sense of Christian love, with a positive, intentional attitude towards our neighbors, as expressed in his treatise on the freedom of the Christian. Martin Luther says, "I will therefore give myself as Christ to my neighbor, just as Christ offered himself for me." And so we call, so we are called to assist our neighbors in numerous ministries. Ministries to heal the sick, ministries to find the lost, ministries to feed the hungry, ministries to rebuild nations, ministries to bring peace where there is conflict, and ministries to make music in the heart. The list is long, and so we ask for God's help to pursue these ministries. Dear Lord God, you have called your servants to many ministries. Give us faith and strong courage to continue along paths, both known and untrodden, always knowing that your hand is leading us and your love is supporting us. Amen.
You can be seated, except that I would like to invite Susan to come on forward. If there is anyone else who with Susan would like to join our congregation at this moment, you can do that as well. Are you going to join, Mom? Is there anyone in the congregation who would like to stand with Susan as she is up here? Thank you. Let us pray. I'm looking at page 234 in the front part of the hymnal, by the way. 234. Merciful God, we thank you for Susan, whom you have made your own by the water and the word in baptism. You have called her to yourself and enlightened her with the gifts of your Spirit and nourished her in this community of faith. Uphold all your servants in the gifts and promises of baptism and unite the hearts of all whom you made and brought to new birth. We ask this in the name of Christ. Amen. Susan, I ask you to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, reject sin, and confess the faith of the church. Do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God? If so, I renounce them. Do you renounce the powers of this world that rebel against God? And do you renounce the way of sin that draws you from God? All can join in this. Do you believe in God the Father? I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You have made a public profession of your faith. Do you intend to continue in the covenant that God made with you in baptism, and that is, to live among God's faithful people? To hear the word of God and share in the Lord's Supper, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ Jesus through word and deed, to serve all people following the example of Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
All right, I'm going to have you both turn and face the congregation. People of God, do you promise to support Susan and pray for her in her life with Christ? If so, we do, and we ask God to help and guide us.
We do, and we ask God to help and guide us.
We pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit you give us all new birth, you cleanse us from sin, and you raise us to eternal life. To so stir up in Susan the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen. Let us all rejoice with our sister in Christ, saying together, we rejoice with you in the life of baptism. Together we will give thanks and praise to God and proclaim the good news to all the world. Susan, welcomed as a member of Redeemer Lutheran Church. We are delighted to have you. Amen?
Amen.
That's awesome. We'll continue our worship with our prayers of the people.
As we celebrate Christ embodied in human form, we pray for God's blessing on the church, the world, and all of creation. Everlasting God, you bring your healing power to the church. Give your church a spirit of unity and prayer that we discern your way for us in the world. Lord, in your mercy. Creator of the ends of the earth, you make the grass grow and send rain for the soil. Bring your creation in. Give animals their food and provide healthy shelter for your people. Inspire us to honor the miraculous beauty of all you have made. Lord, in your mercy. God who strengthens, you lift up with your hand any who are suffering. Heal those who are brokenhearted and strengthen the weak and all in need. Especially we pray. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear.
God, who calls each star by name, we remember all who have died. Shelter all who mourn with your mercy and care, and give us hope in your promised salvation. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear.
Knowing the Holy Spirit intercedes for us, we offer these prayers and the silent prayers of our hearts in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Let's take 3.78 minutes to share Christ's peace with each other. Please read through all of your Redeemer happenings and the prayer concerns that are listed here. Reminder that, well, last week was our Stewardship Sunday, so if you still have some stewardship slips, you can turn them into the, were you going to say something?
I have blank ones if people want blank.
Oh, we have blank ones as well. So yes, if you can turn in your stewardship slip, and that is both for you to say to about your what you'll be able to contribute this year in both time and money. So yes. Ash Wednesday's coming up quick, February 14. Pat let me know that the flowers on the altar, right, are not just for me. Everyone who's born in February, these flowers on the altar are for you, not just the past. Yeah, there is someone with a birthday coming up then. Ash Wednesday is Valentine's Day, but also on February 14th, there will be imposition of ashes for anyone who would like it from noon until 1 at Fircrest Presbyterian parking lot. Pastor Taylor Morgan and I will be there. Pastor Taylor started as their pastor, what was it, about 4 or 5 months ago. So we will be doing that together. And then that night, 7 o'clock, Ash Wednesday at St. John's, and all of our midweek Lenten services are at St. John's this year. So starting on the 21st, we have soup at 6 and our service at 7. They are asking us, as they brought bread rolls and desserts and other things, salads to go with the soup. Last year they brought that to us. They're asking the same of us, that we bring those items to their church on the 21st and following. What am I forgetting? I didn't forget that, but go ahead.
I want to thank everybody that came to our function last time. It was very successful. We had lots of people, and people spent their money, which was good. And also, our Lenten, I haven't brought the clothes to wash yet, because I didn't want to have them over there when we have our meeting. So we'll get them there this week. So if you want to help us wash clothes, we'd really appreciate it. We probably have about 90 bags.
Mm-hmm. All right. That's Sarah.
So I know you guys are going to think this is early, but the Emergency Food Network is already gearing up for, I believe it's May 4th Hunger Walk. And I would like anybody who wants to walk with us. It's a 5K. You may think that's far, but if I can do it, anybody can, believe me. And Pastor Greg can do it. We would also love to have your support voluntarily. I believe they still have, for every dollar, they can feed 5 families. Just let me know if you want to walk. Donate. We'll have an envelope in the office, and just make your checks payable to Emergency Food Network. Also, there is a sign-up sheet for the meeting today on the counter by the food.
Yes, Gail.
My mom spoke with Ernie McCluskey this past week, and for those of you that remember Ernie, I think he left in 2007. He and his wife, Catherine, and their two sons worshipped here, and he just lost his wife, I think, about 3 weeks ago. And so he's going to be here next Sunday. He's going to attend worship service with us, and he said that he would stay after for coffee. For those of you that remember him, you can visit with him.
Anything else? Yes, Ed.
No, on behalf of the council, I want to invite everybody to attend our annual meeting after church. And as Sarah said, there'll be a sign-up sheet, so please sign in. As you go in, grab your food, and as Pastor makes it into the fellowship hall, he'll lead us in grace. And after everyone's got their food and they're seated, we'll call the meeting to order.
Yeah. All right. Birthdays, yes, besides mine, which is later. We are celebrating today. We celebrate Dixie Baim and Ruth Mashalo. I know that Ruth watches online when she's away, so she is with family. And Diane Formoso, it's your birthday as well, right? Woo! Let's sing happy birthday to y'all.
Happy birthday to you.
Let's continue our worship of God through the giving of our regular tithes, special offerings, and this offering of music.
Gracious God, you have given us life, this community, and these gifts of the earth that become the meal of your grace. Move in our hearts that we might use your gifts to bring hope and blessing wherever you go. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord. It is indeed right, our duty, and our joy that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ. By the leading of a star, he was shown forth to all nations. In the waters of the Jordan, you proclaimed him your beloved Son. And in the miracle of water turned to wine, he revealed your glory. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. We remember how in the night of his betrayal, our Lord Jesus took bread. He blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant of my blood, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Drink this, and as often as you drink it, do it in remembrance of me." And so remembering Jesus' words and teachings and the promise that this meal carries, we are bold to pray as he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. This is an open communion table, and all are invited to come and receive Christ's nourishment and promises. Lamb of God, you take time. I invite you to please stand. May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and keep us all from now unto eternal life. Amen.
Let us pray together. Emmanuel, God with us, you grace us with life and breath, and give us bread for the journey. Send us out in your service into this world that you love, telling the amazing news of your coming to be Savior and Lord of all. Amen.
Friends, God bless you and keep you. May Jesus grant you grace and truth, and may the Holy Spirit send peace upon your hearts now and forever. Amen. Let's join in singing. I heard the voice. Oh, thank goodness you're here. Not only did Steve preach for us, but recently he retired. And as we often like to do, Steve, if you would come to the middle and receive a blessing from our naughty ladies. Beautiful. Oh, gosh. I like a hug.
Okay.
Will you send that, again, reach out your hand towards Steve. Lord God, you are there with us through all the different phases of our life. We give you thanks for the life and the ministry, the work of Steve. We ask you, Lord, now as he moves into another stage in his life, that you walk with him, serve through him, and love him. In your name we pray. Amen. Yay. And now we join in singing together hymn number 611.